Bantam Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents Star Wars, The Mandalorian Armor. Book 1 of the Bounty Hunter Wars Trilogy by K.W. Jeter. Now, during the events of Return of the Jedi. The live ones are worth more than the dead ones. That was the general rule of digital appendage for bounty hunters. Dengar hardly needed to remind himself of it as he scanned the bleak and eye-stinging bright wastes of the Dune Sea. So far, he'd spotted a lot more dead things than living, which all added up to a big zero for his credit accounts. He stood at the top of the dune, shielding his eyes from the glare of Tatooine's double suns, and scanned across the wide declivity in front of him. The forms of warriors and bodyguards sprawled across the rocky wastes showed that he'd found the still and silent epicenter of all that fatal action he had so wisely avoided. A whole batch of the galaxy's toughest mercenaries had gone down with Jabba the Hutt's sail barge. Bits and pieces of wreckage of the barge that had served as Jabba's floating throne room lay scattered across the farther dunes. He used a broken shanked scythe staff to poke around the rubble. So much for Luke Skywalker and the rest of them, thought Dengar as the point of the staff revealed sticky and distasteful evidence of Jabba's death. As if that little band of rebels didn't have enough trouble with the whole Empire gunning for them, now they'd have the late Jabba's extended clan after them as well. Dengar lifted a length of chain, the broken metal at its end twisted by blaster fire. The last time he'd seen this hand-forged tether back at Jabba's palace, it had been fastened to an iron collar around Princess Leia Organa's neck. Now the links were crusted with the dried exudations from Jabba's slobbering mouth. The Hutt must have died hard, thought Dengar, dropping the chain. A lot to kill there. One substantial piece of wreckage remained. The hardened durasteel keel beam of the sail barge rose at an angle from where the stern end was buried beneath a fall of rocks. Dengar scrabbled aboard the curved metal and climbed the rest of the way up to where the barge's bow had been. He unslung the electrobinoculars from his belt and brought them up to his eyes. This was a pointless trip, Dengar thought disgustedly. Anything of value was already trundling away in the Jawa's slow, tank-treaded sand crawlers. The knot of frustration in Dengar's gut was instantly replaced with surprise as the keel beam suddenly tilted almost vertical. He held on with both hands as the beam pitched skyward. At the center of the dunes, the slope grew deeper, like a funnel with a black hole at its center. Dengar looked down past his own boots and saw that the hole at the bottom of the sand funnel was lined with teeth. The great pit of Carcoon gaped wider, sand and rubble swirling around the blind, all-devouring sarlacc creature at the center of the vortex. A sour stench hit Dengar like a wind hotter than any that crossed the desert's reaches. Suddenly the beam swayed backward, leaving him dangling precariously only a couple of meters from the sarlacc's throat. A pumping kick enabled him to get first one, then the other of his boot soles up onto the beam. He squatted into a deep knee bend on the narrow metal surface, then jumped, fingertips clawing for the funnel's edge above him. With a gasp of effort, Dengar managed to get his chest across the shifting edge of the funnel, then scrabble the rest of his body over and tumble down the other side. The dune sea grew silent again. The sarlacc had most likely pulled its head back underground and was busy digesting the bits of wreckage it had just been fed. Dengar figured that would give him time enough to get a safe distance away if he hurried. Three dunes later, he stopped to catch his breath. To his amazement, he saw that the scraps of debris, the barely distinguishable pieces of Jabba the Hutt's sail barge, still filled the center of the pit. The truth dawned on him. It's dead, thought Dengar. Something, or someone, had managed to kill the Sarlacc. The rotting stench had been from the creature's own torn-apart flesh, visible beneath the wreckage. Now the sense of life, however malignant, beneath the desert surface was extinguished. Dengar was just about to power off the binocs when he spotted something nearly 50 meters away. Another corpse lay on a stretch of rough gravel. Face up, Dengar could make out the front of a narrow, apertured helmet. That was about all that was intact. The rest of the dead man's gear looked as if it hadn't been burned away so much as dissolved. Some kind of acid bath, reducing uniform and armaments to rags and corroded, pitted shapes of useless metal and plastoid. Dengar thumb-wheeled the binocs into closer focus, trying to figure out what could have happened to create that kind of lethal effect. Wait a minute. Maybe not exactly lethal, Dengar corrected himself. He could see the figure's chest moving, a slight rise and fall, right on the edge of survival. Now that was worth checking out. If only to satisfy his own curiosity. The distant figure looked as if he'd discovered a whole new way of getting killed. As a bounty hunter and general purveyor of violence, Dengar felt a professional interest in the matter. The light on the dying man's face dimmed. The differential in temperature was enough that he could just make out the blurred edges of shadow falling upon him. He wondered what new vision his agony-fractured brain was about to conjure up. There were others he knew here in the belly of the beast. He had seen them fall and be swallowed up. He might as well hallucinate voices from those about to be digested. It would help pass the long, endless hours before his own body's atoms floated free from one another. One of the voices he heard was his own.
Help.
What happened?
Sarlacc swallowed me.
The words seemed to come of their own volition.
I killed it. Blew it up.
Hang on, came the hallucinated voice. I'll get you someplace safe. The man called Boba Fett felt the jostle of the other's footsteps, the motion of being carried across the stony ground. For a moment, his vision cleared, the blindness dissipating enough that he could see his own hand flopping limp and disjointed, leaving a trail of spattered blood on the sand. That was when he knew that what he saw and felt was real, and that he was still alive. Kuat of Kuat had felt the hyperspace messenger pod's approach even before his own corporate security chief came to tell him that it had been intercepted and placed the elongated silver ovoid on Kuat of Kuat's workbench. The hereditary CEO of Kuat Drive Yards, the most powerful contractor of engineering and construction services to the Empire, had a fine-tuned awareness of machines. It was a family trait, something encoded deep within the Kuat blood for generations. He pried open the silvery ovoid, dismantling the pieces of its shell in a precise order, and laid a tender, possessive hand on the holoprojector unit that had been revealed. When Kuat of Kuat activated the holoprojector, the images and sounds of another great room were laid over his office suite. A small adjustment muted the audio portion of the playback. Kuat of Kuat didn't need to hear Jabba's slobbering voice and the cruel laughter of his sycophants to discern what was happening. He froze the playback and walked into the center of the hologram. The forms were insubstantial as ghosts. He could have passed his hand through any one of the sycophants and hangers-on surrounding the hut's throne-like hover platform, but detailed in such perfection that he could almost smell the sweat and rank odors of decay rising from the grates in the synthesized floors. "You're dead, aren't you?" With a thin smile, he brought his face close to the stilled image of Jabba the Hutt. "That's such a shame. I hate to lose a good customer." Over the years, Jabba had commissioned several large orders, lethal equipment for his thugs and hirelings, from KDY's personal armaments division, plus elaborate palace furnishings and a superbly appointed sail barge with military retrofits from one of the Kuat subsidiaries devoted to luxury vessels. There had been extras thrown in that Jabba had known nothing about. Hidden recording devices that had captured nearly everything that took place in the palace on Tatooine and aboard the floating barge. A good contractor, thought Kuat of Kuat, knows his accounts even better than they know themselves. Word of the Hutt's death had already seeped through the galaxy, gladdening many, setting off an acquisitive scramble among others. What he'd already heard about Jabba's death was confirmed by the holographic image. One of Jabba's ineffectual little hands held a length of chain, its other end fastened to a collar around the neck of a human form. Standing at the edge of the recreated platform, Kuat of Kuat appraised with a connoisseur's eye the revealed attractiveness.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.